years ago when yesterday was born. And golden slumbers kissed your eyes while sexy Sadie snored. Oh, life was so much easier. The walrus kept us warm. A splendid time was guaranteed for all. So play those gold songs, the ones we love the best. Those old songs, they'll always stand the test of time. Those melodies will always be a part of you, a part of me. The memories they gave us will never disappear.
Hello and welcome to London. Welcome to this week's Celebrity Spotlight live from London. My name's Paul Endicott from Music Heritage London and the Swinging 60s Tours and Events. And we've got a bit of a special guest for you today. It's a week before Christmas Eve. Places are starting to shut down in more ways than one now. London's gone up to tier three, which means that we've got so many more restrictions in the run-up to Christmas. I'd like to welcome everyone from around the world. I know that we're going to be having visitors from all over the globe. And today we have a special guest. I've known David Stark for about 4 years now. He's Mr. Music in London. Everyone knows David Stark. But he's got a special book out. He's just released his first book, his novel about his time, his memories in the 60s when he was a massive Beatles fan. And I just wanted to tell you also, this is the last Celebrity Spotlight we have until the 7th of January, when we have the infamous John Carter from the Carter Lewis Writing School. The songs that Carter Lewis wrote in the 60s and 70s is a fantastic list. John Carter was also in a couple of bands. The ones that spring to mind are the Flowerpot Men and the Ivy League. And you may remember his voice in that famous 60s song, Winchester Cathedral, where he's got his hands together and he's saying, Winchester Cathedral. Very famous song. So that's for the 7th of January. As I say, we'll be taking a short sabbatical until then. But today is all about our guest, David Stark. I'd like to welcome him onto the show now. Let's click him on board. Welcome, David. Hello.
Hi, Paul. Great to be here. Nice Excellent. To see you. Hello, everybody.
Good to have you on board. I was saying how long we've known each other, and it must be about 4 years since I first met you at the Waffle.
Oh yeah, if not more. Yeah, we've done a lot of stuff together, haven't we, over those years? And playing at the station, 1Q Road, and the Blue Plaques, and all sorts of things.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and the Swinging 60s tours.
Well, you've been on a few of them with some of your mates, which we'll talk about later. We'll go on to the tours, but today is all about you, and you've been a busy boy in the last year or so.
Oh God, yeah. Now this is the last few weeks leading up to this book launch has been the busiest I've known for a long time. I'm trying to do my normal work and got this book, which is literally just slightly late, but just been published today. I have copies in my hands as we speak. The book is out, folks, and it's here. It's just all too much. I can't keep up with it.
Well, but I'm really pleased. I know you've been banging your head against a brick wall to try and get the look. It's right in front of me.
That's right. Because
they were slightly delayed in coming out, weren't they? They only arrived on your doorstep today.
Oh yes, whilst we were doing the test run earlier, and they were supposed, it was due to be out last week, but it was, you know, this time of year, problems with the printers, COVID, and, you know, just the general kind of everything going slow. But, yeah, they suddenly turned up, and they're already going out. So got some out today, and there'll be more going out tomorrow, which I have to, you know, I've got lots of orders, and I have to sign them all. And I've got a little factory lined up for the next day or so, just doing that, which is a pleasure. And thanks to everybody who's ordered them. And your copies will be on their way very shortly indeed. And I hope you enjoy it.
We are going to be talking about your book mostly on this on the next hour or so.
Yeah.
But how would people find out about how do they get the book?
Oh, well, it's available to order. If you want a signed copy, the only way to get one is through the publisher's website, and they're called thisdayinmusicbooks.com. thisdayinmusicbooks.com.
Okay.
And then, yeah.
Well, let's talk about the book and how you... What was the inspiration in writing the book? When did you first become aware of the Beatles? What's the book about, actually? It's probably the best place to start.
Well, it's about my history with the Beatles as a fan since I first heard them at the age of 10 in January 1963, when I first heard Please Please Me on Pick of the Pops with Alan Freeman, and I had no idea who the Beatles were at that point, but as soon as I heard that record, I knew it was something special and a bit different. And although I was just 10 years old, I was already a fan of Cliff Richard, The Shadows, Helen Shapiro, Frank Highfield. So I was always a big music fan right from my early days. And then the Beatles just took over my life. As from that point, from January 63, I found out who they were. Then of course they broke through in a big way, and I started my Beatles scrapbooks in 1963, early 63, and kept them going right through the 60s. So I was a huge fan as a kid, and then as a teenager, a little bit older, I was lucky enough to meet them in various places, gatecrash film premieres, and just kind of made not quite a nuisance of myself, but, you know, I just loved the whole thing. And I mean, it very much relates to what you're doing now with the Swinging 60s tours, was that I was doing all that in reality as a kid in the 60s, trying to be where all the stars were, especially the Beatles, and being lucky enough to live in Northwest London. And my parents didn't mind that I would go up to town and just go to these events and just, you know, get into film premieres and later other events, and just meet the Beatles, as they say, which was great.
You've met them on so many occasions now, but how, as a young kid, as a teenager, young teenager, how did you manage to meet them so many times? When was the first time you actually met them?
Well, the first time properly was when I gatecrashed the premiere of the Yellow Submarine film, July the 17th, 1968, at the London Pavilion. There you go. If you look carefully, you'll see next to Keith Richards in the second row, there's a bit of a gap. There's two seats next to Keith, behind Paul, and his guest for the evening was Jenny Boyd, right on the right-hand side there. But the two seats... Next, it's a long story, which is explained in the book, but it managed to get in and managed to get the manager of the cinema to agree that we were okay to stay. And then we didn't have seats. So I'm standing at the back of that circle until all the Beatles came in, sat down in the front row with all their wives and Yoko. And then I suddenly see these two empty seats. So I went down with my friend and I asked Keith, anyone sitting here? And he said, nah, it's Mick and Marianne, but they're in New York. You're okay there, mate. So that this photo was probably taken about 1 minute before I walked down the aisle and sat down. Literally, it can't have been more than a couple of minutes, because the Beatles had sat down, and the paparazzi, the photographers, they'd all been down there. They'd all gone back up to the rear of the circle. That's when I spotted the seats when they cleared off. And then I just sat down right there. I was sitting directly behind Paul,
beside Keith,
right next to Keith, who was with Anita Pallenberg in the hat there, and sat down to enjoy the film with the Beatles.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, it was incredible for a kid of 15.
Absolutely.
And how I did it, you know, it's the stuff of legend, as they say. And, you know, that was the one time I was with them all at the same place, at the same time, well, in that close proximity to them. And it was just fantastic. And after the film finished, they couldn't move. Everyone was kind of trying to speak to them and congratulate them. And I'm just there. I remember chatting briefly to John and Yoko and George. And in fact, when George walked out, we followed him right up to the foyer. And there's another picture where you can see I'm standing next to George whilst he's being interviewed by some radio or press people. So, it was just wonderful. For a kid of my age, I went back to, well, it was in the school holidays, but I had a pen pal in the States. There you go. That's me right next to George. And by the way, if you look at the spotlight in the center of the picture, you'll see a face just to the left of the spotlight, which I'm pretty sure is Keith Altham, our good pal.
Oh, how is he, by the way?
He's not too bad. You know, Keith saw him a few weeks ago, and I asked him about this, and he thinks it is him. He wasn't 100% sure, but you know, he was there.
Brilliant.
Keith's such a lovely guy, and he worked with the Beatles, the Stones, and so many people. And I'm very proud to call him a friend today. Such a lovely guy.
Oh, he's been there since the beginning. He was the Rolling Stones press officer, wasn't he,
Keith? Absolutely, yeah. You know, he was. Then the Who and everybody. He worked with everybody.
Now we've got a few people to say hello to quickly as we run through.
Okay.
Ulrika from Sweden.
Hello, Ulrika. Hello, Scott.
We've got a few from Sweden here today. Christina from Sweden.
Hi, Christina. Nice to see you. Yeah.
Hello, Cindy from Pennsylvania.
Oh, hi, Cindy. I've got all the ladies looking in tonight. That's
I know. Oh, there's Ken. Hi, Ken from USA.
Hi, Ken.
So you can see we're getting from Portugal. Good night for all.
That's great. Let's hope it is.
David McGeechee from down in Twickenham here. Hello, David.
That has to be the best known man in music. I'm not sure about that, but nice to see you, David. Hope you're well. Yeah.
Hi, Paul and David from New Zealand.
Wow. Hi, Sarah. That's great.
Of course, that must be quite early in the morning for you guys. There's another one here from David. My God, I've seen David around for 33 years.
That's right. I started the party going 20 years before that. I certainly did. And good to see you, David. And here's Janet from Greenwich in Connecticut.
Well, there we go. We're just there's some more there. Australia, Melbourne, Australia. So
this is great.
Let's carry on with the story, because this is absolutely fascinating with regard to, you know, as a young kid to have the bottle to go up and gate crash a Beatles premiere.
The bottle is right.
I mean, you know, that's enough to titillate me to get the book straight away. But there are so many other stories and anecdotes in the book that I want you to elaborate on if you can.
Well, that's right. And this is why it's taken me a long time to get it all together. And you know, over the years, all my friends and other people I know, David, when are you going to do your book? Because people know I've got these stories, but I've never put them down properly And so, you know, I finally done it, which I actually started it 2 years ago. And then last year I had a few health issues. I had had to have cataracts done, which, you know, I couldn't even, it was hard to work, let alone write a book. So that's all sorted now. Then I had carpal tunnel in both my wrists, and, you know, I play drums. So that was a temporary blip for a few weeks, but luckily has also been resolved, and I'm absolutely fine with it now. So it's, you know, I finished it this year, not so long ago, and it's only been thanks to lockdown that I managed to, having the extra time, not going out every night, because everyone knows I like to go out and go to gigs and see bands and just enjoy socializing and networking. But I got down to work to actually get the book finished and sort out all the photographs, of which there's over 100 in the book, and just get it done, and found a publisher who, you know, a good little company who I've been working with, and finally it's out. So I'm delighted, and just in time for Christmas, and I hope it reaches everybody by Christmas as well, certainly within the UK. I just hope it does in abroad as well. But yeah, it's been a labor of love, you know, as a big Beatles fan, and people know I am, but they don't know to what extent and how involved I was with the group back in the 60s, where not only just seeing them as a group on that one occasion at the Yellow Submarine, but then seeing them individually in other circumstances, other encounters, where I met them all, and John, Joel, well, there we are with Paul. Well, that was just a few years ago, where I've been involved with LIPA, the Liverpool Institute for Performing Arts, which Paul is the founder of, with Mark Featherstone Whitty, OBE, who is the CEO of LIPA, which is the most fantastic educational facility in Liverpool, with university status, in fact. And I've been involved for quite a number of years, as I give out the songwriting prizes, the SongLink prizes, every year. And Paul's always there on every graduation day. Until this year, it had to be cancelled, which is such a great shame. But normally I'm giving out prizes on stage with Paul and various other dignitaries and people of note there. So they leave it to me. So they have, LIPA is a school for musicians, songwriters, actors, drama, and technology students, studios and theatre technology, everything. It's all encompassing. It's a fantastic place. So my job is to listen to the songs by the songwriting students every year, and I choose two who receive SongLink prizes. And it's always nice to catch up with Paul McCartney there, because he takes a great interest in all the students, so much so that he actually spends at least half an hour with every single songwriter student, usually in the Easter term, just doing one-on-one sessions with them, talking face-to-face, and even co-writing a song with them, it's been known. So he really does a great job.
You get his hands-on.
Yeah, I've got to show you something I received today in the post as well, if I can just find it, which is the Christmas card from Mark Featherstone Whitty with Paul. How about this for a Christmas card I received today?
That's brilliant.
That's rather special. Yeah.
That's brilliant.
It's a very recent picture of Paul, looking great, and Mark is a lovely guy. So I'm very proud to be involved with LIPA for all these years, and you know, I keep in touch with a lot of the students I've given prizes to, and you know, they're all great. The talent, the standard of talent there is fantastic. They're very special people.
Brilliant. It's a great cause. I mean, you've, over the years, David, it's amazing how many people I've seen you pictured with on your Facebook page, for example. You know, the likes of, who's Joel. That one there?
Sir George Martin.
Sir George himself, Martin.
Who we all miss, and the genius producer, and really the fifth Beatle. He really was.
How long ago that would have been, that photograph, but
that was in 2013 when he received his gold badge award from Basker, which was a really nice event, although I was quite surprised that he actually received it about 20 years after I got mine, so it was well overdue, but a lovely gentleman who I always enjoyed meeting, and he never had a bad word to say about anybody. He had a great sense of humor. And if anybody told him what a wonderful person, wonderful producer he was, he'd just say, oh, well, I didn't. He was very self-effacing about it all. But Brilliant. Really, when I listen to Abbey Road in particular, you can hear his work as much as the Beatles. I mean, for me, it's my favorite album of all time. And thanks to his brilliant arrangements and production on it.
Absolutely.
It doesn't get any better than Abbey Road. It was just a wonderful album. And I want to... Go on.
No, go after you.
Oh, I was going to say, I won a free copy of it, thanks to the Beatles, in 1969, which was in compensation for them not being able to provide tickets to the Beatles TV show I'd won tickets to, which they were planning to do before they played on the roof, which that happened in January 1969. But up to then, they were planning to do a TV special. They'd advertised it in the Beatles Monthly magazine, and I've got this in the book, where they were going to give out 50 pairs of tickets to lucky fans, of which I was one of them. I was absolutely looking forward to going to this TV show wherever it was going to take place. And they'd actually penciled in the Roundhouse for 3 days, which not a lot of people know, but they had done. But they'd also thought about going to an amphitheater in Tunisia and various other locations. But of course, as we now know, it never happened. And they abandoned the idea and just ended up playing on the roof of Apple at 3 Savile Row on January the 30th, 1969, when I was at school, and they didn't tell me about it. I was so annoyed.
That was another opportunity missed, as far as you're concerned, meeting them again. By which time they probably knew you by your Christian name and surname. But there's some lovely other anecdotes in the book about John Lennon when he was turning up to EMI at Abbey Road, and your bike was parked in the driveway of Abbey Road Studios. Tell us about that.
Oh, that's right. Well, I was only 13 at the time, and I had a pal at school, also called David, who lived very near the studios, just along Abbey Road, going towards town, just a couple of blocks away. And at school, he was always telling me, oh, I saw the Beatles arriving, and I got my copy of Help signed by them. I lived in Stanmore at the time, northwest London, a few miles away. So during the Easter holiday of 1966, I cycled all the way up to Abbey Road, met my pal, went to his flat in the morning for a bit of lunch. But he'd been given a drum kit for his 13th birthday and bar mitzvah. And as soon as I saw him playing it, I thought, that's it. That's what I'm going to do. And so on that very day, I played drums for the very first time, and he'd set them up wrongly. He set them up back to front, which is why I play left-handed ever since then to this day. I'm a lefty drummer, thanks to David setting them up the wrong way. But anyway, so we did that in the morning, then had a bit of lunch, and at 2 o'clock, he said, well, let's go down to the studios, well, they're then called EMI Studios, and see if there's anything going on. So I took the bike down, and we walked down, and there's quite a few girls and people out there outside the studios. I put the bike up against the gate, didn't think much of it, and we just joined the crowd waiting for something to happen and maybe one or more of the Beatles to turn up. And then not long afterwards, this huge great limo, Rolls-Royce Phantom 5, slowly comes along the road, but not only can we see it, we can hear a voice inside, because who's got a microphone rigged up to a speaker under the bonnet, under the grill or somewhere, and it's John Lennon doing his kind of gobbledygook, goons-like nonsense talk as the car's coming towards us. I only wish I could have remembered any of it, because it was very funny. But the only bit I do remember, as soon as the car gets to the studio, he says, "I get that bloody bike out the way," which was my bike. So I'm being told off by a Beatle who spoke to me before I ever spoke to him at the age of 13. So I quickly had to get the bike out the way. Then the car goes into the car park, which is very small, as you know, and all the girls, everybody follows the car in, and John, well, he just jumps out the steps and rushes into the studio. So he didn't hang around, but that was it. That's the first time I ever had direct contact with a Beatle in Easter 66.
But it wasn't just the Fab Four. So fast forwarding a few years now, it wasn't just the Fab Four that you got to know. You got to know some of the family. So tell us about this photograph.
Oh, yeah, that's John's lovely Aunt Mimi, who I met. That was taken about 9 months after John was killed. So this is in like late August, September 1981, where I went to visit her because I knew that she had a female fan from the States who she'd become friendly with years ago, was staying with her just for the week. So I went down at the weekend just to come and pay my respects, and I brought her some flowers and just spent the weekend with her, and she's telling me everything about John. And there I am outside Mendips. That's John and Aunt Mimi's old home in Liverpool on Menlove Avenue. So that was also probably around the same time, actually. Excuse me. And Mimi was a lovely person and had no airs and graces at all that I could see, unlike the film that she was portrayed in, the Nowhere Boy film that came out a few years ago. I mean, she did have a slightly more cultured accent than most Liverpudlians, but when I met her, she was very down to earth, and we got on very well, and she made me egg and chips. And that was, I think, my way of passing the audition. And then we sat down to chat on the Saturday evening, and she's telling me all about John as a kid, as a teenager, as the young Beatle. In fact, according to Kathy, she'd hardly spoken much about him at all. And so I feel that being there was a form of therapy for her, but she was coming out of herself at a very difficult time. And she actually wrote a very nice letter to me after my visit, where she writes, and it's in the book, you can see it, "It's been a bad time, don't think I'll ever recover." But she was very appreciative of me visiting, and we kept in touch a bit. And she was just a wonderful person. And by coincidence, my father had a sister who died at an early age in the late 20s, early 30s, who was also called Mimi. So I would have had my own Aunt Mimi had she died, after whom my niece, my brother's daughter, Mimi, is named after. So we have a Mimi in the family. And, she's a lovely girl, and she's working in the music business already. She's working for Judd Lander, famous PR.
Oh, yeah, promoter. I spoke with Judd. Yeah. I spoke with Judd a couple of months ago.
He's a great, yeah.
He would be perfect to have a chat to on one of these celebrity spotlights, because again, he's brilliant.
He's doing his book, and he can give you amazing stories as well.
Fantastic. Now, did you? I've got a photograph here of Cynthia.
Yes. Now this is This is Cynthia Lennon with Barbara Orbison, Roy's widow, who I knew Barbara very well. Since I started Songlink, she became a very good friend. But I'd already met her with Roy once in 1988, just a few weeks before he died. I met them in Antwerp at his last ever European appearance. Cynthia, I'd met a few times, but that evening at Abbey Road was for Cancer Research UK for their Sound and Vision event, which raised a lot of money and which normally does every year and had to be cancelled this year. But Barbara and Cynthia, I don't think they knew each other up to that point. So I might have introduced them. I can't quite remember. But the picture, you can't quite see it, but they're both standing in front of photos of their late husbands. There you can see John behind Cynthia. There's some pictures of him, paintings, I think. And Roy is further up. You can't see him in this, but it was a nice shot, and they're both smiling. I love this picture. Both good picture. Two lovely ladies, and we miss them both because Cynthia died 5 years ago of cancer, and Barbara had pancreatic cancer, very sadly, and died 9 years ago on the same date that Roy died, so it was December the 6th.
Unbelievable. Yeah, unbelievable.
All these coincidences. So lovely, lovely ladies they were.
David, I'm going to have a little break from you talking about the book because it's not only an author that you are, and I'm really looking forward to reading it. So hopefully a copy will be purchased very shortly, although I have so many books to read at the moment. I'm still waiting to finish Leslie Ann Jones's one about John Lennon, etc.
Yeah.
I've had another one land on the desk. So, about 10 years ago, you wrote a song which we have now adopted as our signature tune for the Celebrity Spotlights.
I'm very honoured. Very honoured.
I've had so many fantastic reports about it, and you know, people have said, "Wow, you know, who wrote that, etc." I'm going to play. I play it in its entirety with the original. Video that you put together. So let's have a listen to that.
Remember all those years ago when yesterday was born and golden slumbers kissed your eyes while sexy Sadie snored. Oh, life was so much easier. The walrus kept us warm. A splendid time was guaranteed for all. So play those ghost songs, the ones we love the best. Those old songs, they'll always stand the test of time. Those melodies will always be a part of you, a part of me. The memories they gave us will never disappear. And in a time when love was all and flowers were in your hair, we all enjoyed the Hendersons, a Pablo Fancas fair. Even though the orchestra has left the bandstand bare, the music still surrounds us everywhere. So play those ghost songs, the ones we love the best. Those old songs, they'll always stand the test of time. Those melodies will always be a part of you, a part of me. The memories they gave us will never disappear. Entertaining, celebrating, meditating years. Yesterday was born, and golden slumbers kissed your eyes while sexy said he's not. And though the dream is over and the dreamer's eyes are sealed, we can't forget the songs that made it real. So play those ghost songs, the ones we love the best. Test the time, those melodies will always be a part of you, a part of me. The memories they gave us will never disappear.
Absolutely fantastic. Why have you kept that covered up for the last 10 years? It's a fantastic song.
I haven't. It's been up on YouTube. Maybe it hasn't had as much attention as I'd like, but, you know, it's there for anyone to see. And I had a great little band behind, you know, we put it together. Yeah, just over
Diesel 10 Martin years. Diesel Martin on slide guitar.
What a great solo it is. An absolutely brilliant George-style solo. It's really great. And the singer is Ben. There he is, Ben Champness, also known as Shrimpy from EastEnders. Yeah, hi, Ben, if you're watching. Yeah, he's a great guy, great singer and actor, and I'm so pleased he's doing well in EastEnders. And so I'd started writing this song after John died, probably maybe 1981, 82. And I played with the guitar I just made a very, very rough early demo of it at that time. Never got it finished, never did anything with it. And it was only obviously nearly 30 years later when I thought, I've got to get this song finished. I've got to do it. So eventually, I had to finish writing it. I didn't have all the lyrics written, and went into the studio run by a good pal of mine, John Hamilton, at EQ Studios, which is in Kensal Green in northwest London. And John does work with a lot of songwriters. He's brilliant. He helps to make their demos, and he's a really good guy. So spent a lot of time there with John, putting it together and, you know, getting the arrangement right, getting every, you know, had Diesel and Ben and Phil Nelson, another ex-band mate, who also did brilliant backing vocals on it, and just did take a while. And in fact, John, he was pulling his hair out by the end, because I was spending so much time trying to, this was going to be the nearest I would ever get to a George Martin-style production, and I think we pulled it off.
Oh, it's brilliant.
And we did, in the end, yeah, John was going crazy because we did 67 mixes of it before I was happy. I remember it was 67 mixes. So, but I'm very proud of it, and I'm glad if everybody likes it.
Well, it's played every week now on our show, so hopefully that will carry on for however long and help to promote it, David.
Oh,
so
thanks very much.
It should be out there a lot more. So, coming back to some of the anecdotes and stories in the book, one of the famous gigs that you went to, call it a gig, was the Rolling Stones, where, I mean, gosh, it was an evening where it was jam-packed full of 60s celebrities, the Rock and Roll Circus.
Oh yeah, well, not just an evening. It was almost a full day because I was there all day, and it was the Stones, and then you can see John and Yoko there, Eric Clapton, and there were other, Jethro Tull, Marianne Faithfull, Taj Mahal, who was fantastic, and others on the bill, and the Who, of course. What other event? I was so lucky to be there. I'd won tickets through the New Musical Express. They had a ticket giveaway, and I was one of the lucky winners. There I went to the studios. Was in Stonebridge Park, very near Wembley, which I didn't live too far away. So we went there on December the 10th, 1968, and spent the day there. And it was amazing because we were watching. It was really, they were making it up virtually as they went along. But the Stones were, well, Mick was dressed in his red riding gear and top hat, ringmaster gear. And we'll come to that one afterwards. But yeah, so, and they had, you can see, Wild West guy and horses. They had dwarves, little people, as they say, Indians. So it was a full circus entourage. And I remember not only seeing everybody, but smelling the hay. It had a distinctly farmyard smell that day in the studio, but it was very special. And the other thing is that the entire audience were given these ponchos and hats to wear, which were all colored. So the whole audience looked like a bunch of munchkins. So we were wearing those, and we saw quite a lot of it. But the thing is, I was just 16 then, and we would have loved to have stayed for the whole thing, but it went on until, I don't know, 3 or 4 in the morning. The Stones didn't actually get on until about at least 2:30 the following morning, by which time my pal and I had already gone. So we actually missed the Stones playing because we had to get back home. It was a bit of a shame, but at least we saw everybody during the earlier part of the day when they're doing all the announcements and the parade before the whole thing started. So we saw the Stones, we saw John and Yoko and Clapton, and very lucky to be there at all. And wow. For me, being a huge Beatles fan, and just this was John's probably his first solo appearance, I think, and he played with the supergroup, which was John, Eric Clapton, Keith Richards on bass, which annoyed Bill Wyman no end to this day, I believe, and Mitch Mitchell from the Jimi Hendrix Experience on drums. And they played Yeah Blues from the White Album, which had only been released 3 weeks earlier. As I wrote the book, I got the White Album. Little did I know that I would be seeing John Lennon 3 weeks later, and he was going to be performing it. And Yoko performed one of her wonderful Scream Fest numbers, which they called A Whole Lot of Yoko, with a violin player as well. Yeah, but just being there together. And okay, so I've got a history with that film because it was owned. The film wasn't released until 1996. Just 32 years after the event, because it was owned by ABCO. Alan Klein, who managed the Beatles and the Stones, Stones had kind of not wanted it to be put out for so many years because they thought the Who had upstaged them, and Mick wasn't happy with his performance, blah, blah, blah. But I think they did a great performance, even though Brian Jones was looking totally wasted. That was his very last performance with the Stones and the only time I ever saw him. But eventually ABCO put it out in 1996. Alan Klein's daughter, Robin, happened to have been a very good friend of mine who I'd always visit in New York. And she was the editor of the film. And her boyfriend at the time, Mick, is a good pal of mine. He was doing the sound. And they came over here, and I was a consultant on it. who had to help sort out who was who playing in each band and who, you know, who was on screen. So I get a very nice credit at the end of the video and the DVD version, which says, thanks to so-and-so and so-and-so, and David Stark and everybody's mums, is how it goes. So, so that was rather nice. And then it's been reissued in a couple of formats, most recently in 4K a couple of years ago. And it's a wonderful, film. And they've done it such a great mix that you can sit down, I can sit down, listen to it, watch it on the big screen on headphones or whatever. And it's like I'm back there in 1968. It's wonderful.
So a little bit later on, you know, you start getting invited to these events here. So tell us about this. Oh. Hello, David.
I'm back again. Sorry about that.
That's okay. I'm just saying.
Yeah. Yeah, so this is when I was actually invited to the final Beatles film premiere, Let It Be, in May 1970, which was, you know, just really great to be. I was still at school. To be invited by the Beatles and United Artists to the premiere was great. And, of course, it was a great shame they weren't all there, mainly because they'd broken up the month before, officially, in April 70. But I was there, and the film... It was a little bit of a letdown because a lot of it is quite the early scenes in Twickenham Film Studios, which is, I know, part of your 60s tour, where the Beatles rehearsed and filmed some of this stuff. It wasn't great. It was a bit depressing, even though, you know, it's part of history. And it's only thanks to the rooftop concert in the last third of the film that it really picked up. And that's... You know, that really made it a great experience just to see them one more time doing their thing on the roof of Apple, where I should have been, of course, that day.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, I mean, your book sounds like it's jam-packed full of fantastic anecdotes and stories.
Yeah. It's got all these, yeah.
And we'll make sure that... at the end of the show, we can remind people where they can find it. Hopefully in time for Christmas, but if not, then it's certainly something to read in the new year. I just want to go on to your music, because we've spoken about the book and what a great author you are and everything else, and you've been in so many lucky situations in visiting and meeting some of your icons, your people that you held in high esteem. Quite incredible how you can do that. But you've also pretty good with the old music yourself. And you've played for me a couple of times at the old Station Hotel in Richmond, which was the where the Rolling Stones kicked off their career.
Absolutely, yeah.
On some of the gigs that we've put on there. I wanted to show people the Trembling Wilburys. This is the lineup here. The Trembling Wilburys are a cover band, obviously, of the Travelling Wilburys.
Great tribute band.
And you know, the George Harrison and the Big O, David as Roy Orbison, are absolutely phenomenal. I'm going to play a track or a couple of tracks, a couple of videos of you guys in action.
Okay.
Let's have a look at this.
Been beat up and battered around, been sent up and I've been shot down. You're the best thing found. Handle me with care. Reputation's changeable, situation's tolerable. Maybe you're adorable. Handle me with care. I'm so tired of being lonely. I still have daycare centres and night schools. Handle me with care. He's stuck in airports, terrorised, sent to meetings, hypnotised, overexposed, commercialised.
Well, there we go.
Yeah.
I've caught you eating there, you naughty boy.
Oh, that's my question. Yeah, that's great to see that again. Hello, guys, if any of you are watching.
Great.
Yeah, it's a great band. And, you know, we've been going 10 years. We should have been celebrating our 10th anniversary last Sunday at the Half Moon in Putney, which, of course, is almost, is like our spiritual home these days, right in your neck of the woods. But it's been... That's been put back till next March, so I hope we can actually do it. We haven't played a single gig all year. It's such a shame. So here's hoping we'll be back on the road and
well,
you know, back on stage next year.
Back on the road is kind of, you know, what I was going to say about the tours as well, because with lockdown, obviously, we haven't been able to get our buses. Our Route Master bus, this was the original shot at a launch. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Did you come along to this? I can't remember.
Probably.
That was some 5 years ago. We have John Fiddler from Medicine Head in the middle there with the glasses. And And Peter French from...
I can see Peter.
And there's...
Andrew Hart, I can see.
Yeah.
Oh, very good. And some Fab Four type people as well.
Oh God, we got those along. They were the Beatles for us, or something. Some of our staff there as well. But over the last few years, we've had, you know, there's old Mick Avery from the Kinks in the middle with Top Topham on the left.
Yeah.
And you arranged this for us.
Yes, so I did.
Mr. Stark with next to Bruce Welch and Brian Bennett. And and Kenny Jones and the lovely Leslie Ann Jones.
Yeah.
So, you know, we're really missing doing these tours. There's Steve Hackett a few years ago came on and acting as our commentator.
Yeah, so I missed them as well.
You've been doing
a great job.
Well, we've now gone online, as many of our guests may have heard, so... Now we've got our psychedelic minibus. We're actually going out and we're able to do these tours through Zoom, live through Zoom. So anyone in the world can now access these tours through through Zoom on their computers or their smartphone from anywhere in the world. And for December, they are free of charge. So you basically sit with us inside and the front. That's the view that you get as you travel down the streets of London.
Yeah, so, I've been on that.
So that's enough about that. But say we've got them every weekend through December. So, David, where can people find the book? If they wanted to get the book, give us an email address or a website.
Well, okay. Well, as I said earlier, the site to buy a copy, if you want it signed, then it's no extra apart from postage on the publisher's site, which is thisdayinmusicbooks.com. thisdayinmusicbooks.com. And they've got a lot of other great music books, so you'll just have to scroll down just a couple of rows and you'll find mine. But it's also up on Amazon, but I've only got my stock in today, so they haven't got their stock on Amazon just yet. They're saying they're going to ship it after Christmas, so they're running a bit late there, but there won't be signed copies available from Amazon. But otherwise, those are the two main places. And incidentally, I've also recorded an audio version of it. I've got an audio book, which is me narrating the whole book, plus special features. It's got the song in there, Gold Songs, which kind of a snippet introduces the book, and the whole song is played at the end, plus another special feature is that I did an interview with John Lennon's best pal from the age of six, was Pete Shotton, who became a member of the Quarrymen, original member, and was John's best friend throughout his life. And I did this interview that's me and the Quarrymen. That's another occasion. I played drums with the Quarrymen a few years ago, and that's on the right, that's me on the left, and Marco from the Wilburys on the right. We were very honored to be honorary quarrymen for one night only. There I am with Rod Davis and Len Gary on the left. What a great night that was. And I love the guys are great. We've even got the right shirts for it, and I love them. So, what was I saying? Yes, the audio book. I've only just got the link for that, and it is available to buy right now. It's not an Amazon link, it's a completely different company, but I like the look of them, so I went with them. But anybody wants to know it, I'll happily give out the link. If people want to email me, well, I'm on Facebook. It's under facebook.com/songlink. You can message me at Facebook, yeah, Songlink, and also Songlink is the name of my company, songlink.com, for songwriters and music publishers and composers, so you can find me that way as well. So if you want an audio book or any more information, just let me know.
Excellent. Thanks, David. There's just a couple more comments coming up here.
Yeah.
Glenn Naylor is amazing as George.
Absolutely is. Hi, Laura. Great to see you, darling. Great.
We've got quite a few. There's so many comments coming through. We just haven't had time to read them all. There's Christina, one of our mates. Enjoy this very much. Must get the book.
I think you must. Yeah. Yeah. No, thanks. That's great.
Hi from Netherlands.
Hello. I lived in Amsterdam for a couple of years. Hi, Helena.
Hi from New York. So yeah, we are seeing people from all over the globe, which is fantastic.
This is great. Really enjoying it. And
well, listen, David, it's really good you coming on board. I really appreciate that.
My pleasure.
Really good seeing you on here. We're going to meet up very soon anyway after this lockdown. This horrible lockdown is over. I hope you'll join me in wishing everyone a very Merry Christmas. We've got Christmas coming up in just over a week. I can't believe it.
A week tomorrow. It's unbelievable.
A week tomorrow.
Where did that year go? Yeah.
I know. So it kind of leaves me to say thank you very much. I'm going to tail end it now, and I'm going to play out with another Trembling Wilburys song after I say goodbye to everyone. But I hope we'll meet soon after Christmas, soon after the lockdown is over again, and let's get some music back at 1Q Road. Thank you so much for coming on board, David. I appreciate it, and we'll catch up soon.
Thanks, Paul. That's great.
Take care.
See you soon.
There we go, ladies and gents. As I say, we are now off the air for Christmas until the 7th of January. The tours, the online tours, are still going on from anywhere in the world. You can access those Saturday and Sunday. Just click this little link here. Let me see where it is. There we go. So you can find our tours on that web address, and you go straight to them. They're free to join in December. And I'd like to wish you all a very Merry Christmas and look forward to seeing you in the new year, unless you come on the tours over the next few weekends. And I'm going to play you out with another Trembling Wilburys song, and have a lovely time. Stay safe out there and be good. Take care.